Hjelmdaller man, the man from Hjelmdall.
The cover of this tattered paperback features the man from Hjelmdall standing atop a pile of bloody corpses. His two Zweihanders are crossed over his massive chest in a dramatic X, their blades dripping with gore.
Hell yeah.
Behind him rise the harsh, snow-capped peaks of his native Northlands. In bold red letters, the title, Hjelmdaller Man, the man from Hjelmdall, unfurls like a banner. In the foreground, a nearly nude woman lies spread in supplication, her privates strategically covered by her flowing black hair.
Yeah, no, I know the image.
These images speak to something burbling deep within you. Quick, find someone or something that needs to be gutted, beheaded, impaled on a spike.
Let's have a look at the back. Wait, hold on. Put the book away. Now we can continue.
The man from Hjelmdall.
Back cover.
The back blurb reads, his latest adventure serves as the perfect introduction to the savage Hjelmdall saga. Meet man from Hjelmdall, his faithful blood brother, Tiribald, the noble Lord Hrothgar, and some of their most fearsome foes yet, for the Northlands, for Hjelmdall. Below, in smaller font, you see the parenthetical, adapted from Man from Hjelmdall and the Necromancer's Treasure, Man from Hjelmdall, Lord of Hrothgar, and Man from Hjelmdall, the Curse of Naktera. A brazen attempt to bilk fans for more money by splicing together old stories under a new title.
Incredible. So incredibly real. Publishers must have a dim view of their readership.
Their main concern is the continuation of the franchise, not making literary history.
Yeah, that's fair. All right, let's read it.
The story opens in media res. The man from Hjelmdall and his band of northern reavers are in the bowels of an ancient temple, surrounded by an army of gibbering wights, led by the deathless necromancer. One by one, the brave northmen fall to the relentless crush of undead, only to join their number as reanimated corpses.
Mm-hmm.
By nightfall, only the man from Hjelmdall and his blood brother, Noble Tiribald, are left standing against the dead horde. It is an honor to die by your side, brother, Tiribald cries, as his battle axe beheads one of their reanimated comrades.
Wow, they're in trouble now.
Nine, Tiribald, the man from Hjelmdall bellows Nine? Over the army of flesh and bone.
That's... But
have
wait.
Courage for the Northlands, for Hjelmdall. He leaps to the mezzanine to face the black-eyed figure, and like a mad ice bear, whirling twin Zweihanders, Sturm and Drang, he plows through the ranks of the deathless, surrounding the necromancer.
I feel like we're mixing up some different European areas. That's probably fine.
The writer has never held a sword in their life, let alone two two-handed swords at the same time. It is physically impossible for a human being to effectively dual-wield Zweihander swords in any kind of real-life combat situation.
Thank you, Logic. I was also thinking that, but you know, whatever.
And with deadly finesse, his twin blades scissor the necromancer's head from its body. The undead legions collapse like ragdolls, as the dark magic leaves them, and the two Northmen stand alone in their cursed temple, where the bodies of their lost brothers litter the floors.
Skip!
A few chapters later, the man from Hjelmdall and Tiribald are in a completely different setting, high above an arid desert, riding a pair of griffins that always seem to appear at narratively convenient moments.
Mm.
The Northmen find themselves in the court of a powerful southern king, Lord Hrothgar. The old king beseeches the man from Hjelmdall to rid his kingdom of the Naktera, a subterranean clan of blind wizards who traded their souls for demonic powers.
Why did blind wizards catch me as so funny?
The man from Hjelmdall extracts a high price from the desperate king. He asks land for the homeless desert pygmies living exiled in the kingdom's borderlands. Hrothgar offers the hand of his eldest daughter instead, but the son of winter does not budge.
Hold on, why?
What do you mean?
Why?
Because the flame of justice burns bright within his chest. Because, above all, he's driven to bring honor to the name of his beloved, Hjelmdall. Because his noble Cutland blood lusts for glory and conquest. It cannot be denied.
Is that all?
What do you mean, is that all?
Is there anything else to his character?
He is the man from Hjelmdall, forged in the fury of battle. Death was his sire, and blood his dam. He had but 14 winters when he left his frigid homelands in Cutla to seek glory and honor. That is his character.
Never mind, just get to the good part.
You skip past a section detailing an elaborate banquet with many toasts, as well as the long and perilous journey from Hrothgar's keep to the ancient forest of Yesdor, where our heroes infiltrate the Naktherr's dire hall. In the center of the great hall stands a blood altar on which a pair of Naktherr are disemboweling a shrieking peasant, an unholy rite that empowers the Naktherr forbidden magic.
Uh-huh.
As the vile ceremony ends, the sound of steel unsheathing draws the Naktherr's attention to a pair of cloaked figures standing in the doorway. This is what you came for, isn't it? A climactic bloodletting, where men are reduced to muscle and fury.
I guess?
Swiftly, the visitors toss off their cloaks and unsheathe glimmering northern steel. It's the man from Hjelmdall and his valiant blood brother, Tiribald.
Whoa, I did not see that coming!
In an instant, the Naktherr summon a horde of gibbering orcanoids who rush our heroes. The hall fills with the clang of blades and the screams of the dying as the floor goes slick with steaming orcanoid viscera.
No one expects viscera.
When the din of battle settles, only the man from Hjelmdall and Tiribald remain standing. Exhausted and dripping with the entrails of their foes, the two Northmen confront the foul Naktherr. The man from Hjelmdall's soda-like blue eyes fill with indescribable fury. For the Northlands, he cries, rushing headlong into a desperate melee.
You gotta cut him up!
He probably is, but you can't be sure, because this one ends in a cliffhanger and a footnote saying, to be continued in Hjelmdall Man at the Gates of Tomorrow. Coming soon to your local bookstore.
They have the nerve to cut together three stories into a new book and leave it on a cliffhanger?
Considering the sheer amount of different Hjelmdall Man books out there, it's very unlikely you're ever gonna find the sequel. The man from Hjelmdall stares at you on the cover, his face fixed in grim resolve.
I'm good. Anyway, time for the man from Hjelmdall and the Devil Woman!
The edges of the pages are worn and smudged. A lot of people have read about the Devil Woman's altercations with the Hjelmdall Man.
Let's look at that back cover.
The jacket copy proclaims, Man from Hjelmdall returns in his most exciting adventure yet. After crashing into a strange jungle, cannibalistic natives abduct his only surviving comrade, Noble Tiribald. Before Man from Hjelmdall can mount a rescue, he is ambushed by a tribe of female warriors and taken to the ancient citadel of Cloud City, where a mysterious and wicked queen rules supreme. Will Man from Hjelmdall be able to escape his dire situation and find his missing friend?
Probably. Let's flip through it.
You open the book to a random page. Man from Hjelmdall, wielding his two Zweihanders, is carving through a sea of savages.
Yikes.
His visage fixed in grim determination.
Yikes.
His arms whirling like windmills are soaked with the blood of his enemies. Mangled corpses litter the battlefield.
That would not be effective, especially not with Zweihanders.
You flip to the copyright page. This book was written in 38.
Let's give it a chance.
Berserker rage burns in his azure-hued eyes as he brings glory and honor to his long-lost Hjelmdall tribe from the village of Hjelmdall. The ivory giant roars like an ice bear, and the winds of Gatla howl out his name.
More.
Man from Hjelmdall rides on a gilded griffin, his golden mane billowing in the breeze. Both Zweihanders sheathed on his back. He is off to war. Will he conquer his enemies? Will he conquer himself?
More!
The steel muscles of man from Hjelmdall gleam in the humid jungle air. Yet the man does not sweat. In meditation, his soul drifts in the frigid northlands he calls home.
Like, glistening muscles but doesn't sweat is so incredibly specific. Holy shit, this is so me.
A passage reads, the man from Hjelmdall looks up, his eyes blue as the mountain lakes of his homeland. He rarely speaks, but now his voice booms in the darkened throne room. Do not try to sap my masculine essence, wicked temptress. Son of Hjelmdall will never succumb to your seductive wiles. Thine spells are no match for purity and strength of will. Brothers of Hjelmdall, stand above the vices of flesh, for it is weak and corruptible, yet mine is forged in gore and strife. Queen Lydiana just laughs, a sultry and salacious sound, then says,
sounds like Hjelmdall man goes his own way.
I have grand plans for you, man from Hjelmdall. She gestures her diabolical hand toward an array of potions and unguents. First, you shall please me. Then, lead my armies against the vicious cannibals. Not a muscle moves in the face of the man from Hjelmdall. Yet, inside, there is turmoil. This goes against all he holds sacrosanct.
I kept hoping it would get better, but the writing is terrible and repetitive.
What do you even know about literature? Have you ever read a book in your life?
I literally read one 5 minutes ago.
This is not just another book. It's Man from Hjelmdall, and it's done with you.
Okay, no, we have to get into it.
You flip to the copyright page. Berserker raid, man from the steel muscles, a passage read, thine, I have grand plans for you.
This is epic.
In the final pages, man from Hjelmdall mounts Galavarin, his mighty griffin.
Oh, not the woman.
His gaze,
okay.
To the horizon. Queen Lydiana is dead, but an army of cannibals is storming the gates, and still, there's no word of trusty Tyrobald. To find out what happens next, you'll have to pick up Man from Hjelmdall and the Three-Eyed Skull, available in fine bookstores everywhere, Spring 39.
Yo, this is actually passing time faster than I thought. Like, I didn't realize that time would actually skip by while we're reading, so this is actually quite useful. It makes sense.
Shelves
it's like
filled to the brim with crime novels featuring the supposedly stalwart Vespertine detective, Dick Mullen.
Of course. Such violence and immorality. I mean, enjoy.
You're really selling your own, you're really selling your own merchandise here.
Shelves full of biographies of famous people. This bookstore is not strictly about crime, Rome.
Sir, I can't have you end up, like, opening a police store next door and stealing my customers.
Right. Yeah, that's what I'm thinking, too. This other one's not too expensive.
Shelves full of
like, we're broke now, but we literally need, like, $3. But for now. Boy, that's a thick boy. I have definitely not ever read a book that thick before.
In your hand, you hold Dick Mullen and the mistaken identity. The brittle paperback feels fragile to the touch.
Examine.
The cover features a pastiche of different scenes. In the foreground, a man in a dark overcoat clutches a pistol to his chest. Rising up behind him are two silhouettes wrapped in a passionate embrace. The tagline reads, Detective Dick Mullen must prove his innocence after an old friend is murdered by someone who looks just like Dick Mullen. That seems to sum up the premise nicely.
That's a premise.
Are you really reading that, Detective?
I need to know who this Dick Mullen guy is.
Good luck finding it. He's not much of a character, I think you'll find. Just a stand-in for the reader.
Yeah. Yeah, there's a lot of that. Read it.
The story opens with a knock at the
door. Oh, hey, yeah, that.
Detective Dick Mullen is greeted by an old friend, Charlie Spillane, who's come to Mullen to ask a favor on this dark and cold night. Spillane needs Mullen to drive him in from Vespa to a small town along the Insulindian coast. Despite his friend's apparent agitation, Mullen does as he's asked, then returns home where he passes out drunk, as he does most nights.
I can't judge.
2 days later, Mullen is arrested by the Vespa police and charged with the murder of Charlie Spillane. At his interrogation, Mullen learns that Charlie Spillane was shot in a bar in the very town Mullen dropped him off in, by a man matching Mullen's description. Desperate to clear his name, Mullen manages to convince the Vespa police to release him for 3 days so that Mullen may solve his friend's murder and prove his innocence.
The cops release their prime murder suspect so he can find the real killer. Are you shitting me? There's no way he did it.
Of course, Mullen didn't do it. That's the whole premise of the book. Anyway, Mullen returns to the seaside bar where Spillane was murdered and meets a beautiful, mysterious woman named Diana De Nerva.
Nice, a dame!
And not just any dame. She's truly one in a million. A knockout whose mind is as dangerous as her curves. But she's got a secret.
That sounds good.
She's any man's kind of woman, according to this book.
Yeah. That's, yeah.
Are you sure about that? Something about her gives you a bad feeling. What kind of secret is she hiding?
I feel like our particular... I feel like Raphael here may have a bad history with women with secrets.
You couldn't handle a woman like that. Look at yourself. You couldn't even handle your...
Morale damage!
Stop. Don't say it.
Emotional damage!
Nothing. Forget it. Go back to your story.
Keep reading. Don't think about it.
Deneuve reveals that she was Belaine's lover, and that he was mixed up with a local amphetamine smuggling operation. As soon as Mullen begins pulling at strings, the whole conspiracy begins to unravel. Not only is the local police captain in on the amphetamine ring, so is the son of a powerful politician and a strung-out art collector named Torvald, each of whom has his own reasons for wanting Spillane dead.
Tell me about the cops.
Outwardly, the old police captain is a real law and order crypto-fascist, a barrel-chested man who's beaten his share of suspects to pulp. But he's also dirty and increasingly paranoid that someone's going to expose his role in the drug ring.
A barrel-chested man who's beaten his share of suspects to pulp, but also dirty.
He would certainly have the motive and the means, but the captain walks with a noticeable limp from an old war injury. Is it possible that he was able to conceal it long enough to commit the murder?
Tell me about the politician's son.
A typical privileged twat. In all likelihood, he's just in over his head. He does bear a personal grudge against Belaine, though. A former prosecutor who nearly brought down his father's administration. The kid doesn't exactly have Dick Mullen's manly build, but he is the correct height. And while interrogating him at his home, Mullen did notice a certain overcoat that looks suspiciously like his own.
What was that about an art collector?
Torvald, the art collector, is a strung-out mess. Frankly, it's hard to imagine him holding a pistol steady enough to actually hit someone, let alone plug them 3 times in the chest the way
the old Spillane got did.
That said, Torvald and Spillane have a long history, and while interrogating him, Mullen discovers that Torvald was once involved with Deanna Deneuve. Could it be that this is all over a sordid love triangle?
All right, more story.
One evening, Deanna Deneuve comes to Mullen's hostel room in tears. The two of them drink half a bottle of vodka, and soon they're seeking comfort in each other's arms.
A predictable development.
Yes, comfort and pleasure. The warmth of another human's touch. The burning taste of liquor on her full, sweet lips.
I'm not sure I'm happy with this, but maybe the story will turn it around.
As the two lovers share a post-coital cigarette, Deanna Deneuve turns to Mullen and says, "By the way, Dick, there was something else I meant to tell you."
The story's not going to turn it around.
The name of the true killer. Always aim for the center of mass. Whatever it is, Mullen never hears the words. A blow to the base of his skull knocks him out cold instantly.
Can't trust a dame! Fuck.
When Mullen comes to, Deneuve is dead on the hostel bed next to him. To make matters worse, his clothes are covered with her blood.
Double fuck!
Mullen trashes his blood-stained clothes and flees the hostel, knowing it's only a matter of hours before the cops discover Deneuve's body, if they haven't been tipped off already. The heat is on. If Dick Mullen can't solve both murders before the cops catch up to him, he's going away for life. Can you solve the case before the cops close in?
I have questions.
What is it, detective?
Why does everyone close to Dick Mullen wind up dead?
It's a dangerous line of work, but somebody has to do it. That's why Dick Mullen never lets anyone get too close.
Oh, God. Oh, man.
What's the matter? Afraid you've been hacking up your friends' bodies in the night?
Why did you become a detective in the first place?
There was never a time when he wasn't a detective. He was born a detective.
But why is he like that?
Dick Mullen was made to crack skulls and solve cases. It's who he is. He could no more stop being a detective than a tiger could cease to be a predator in the night. For a moment, you cease to read the story on the page and see the book for what it is. A collection of brittle, cheaply printed pages held together by glue made from the hooves of horses. From nowhere, you hear the screech of sneakers on a waxed floor, and you feel the burn of rope against your hands. Are these figments of some other life?
Pale?
You won't find the answers you're looking for here, in other words.
Why bother solving crimes when the world is so evil?
Is it really so evil, detective?
There are parts worth saving.
Like what?
Friends and family.
Do you even have those?
I've got Kim!
Just make sure you don't lose him. You'll not find another like him.
You damn right.
But then, what does this book know? It's just a poorly made piece of pulp garbage made to be consumed and discarded.
Oh God, Kim's gonna die, isn't he? I mean, obviously don't answer that, but like it, for some reason, the possibility had not even like crossed my mind. All right, I figured it out.
So who did it, detective? Who killed Charlie Spillane and Deanna Deneuve?
No!
What? That doesn't even make sense. There's never a straight answer with you, is there? You just get hooked on random stupid notions and then repeat them every chance you get.
You know that like anime meme where someone is saying something that's like brutally honest about you and it just hits you really hard, and it's always like portrayed as like being hit with arrows? and the arrows are all like labeled with like whatever is being said. Like doesn't make sense. Never a straight answer. Hooked on random stupid notions. Repeat them every chance you get.
Now go on. Find out who really did it. You begin furiously flipping through pages. Even as you know these books follow a series of well-worn tropes, you find yourself completely engrossed. You're turning pages so fast, you don't even notice the ancient spine coming unglued.
Tropes are tropes for a reason. You know, they organize stories in a way that makes them consumable and interesting. And people like them.
You try to grab the pages as they come loose, but your fingers aren't quick enough. They're gone.
Jesus.
Dozens of pages scatter across the floor. The last fifth or so of the book seems to have been lost. It's possible that you could gather and reassemble the pages, but it would take way too long.
Stupid horse glue.
Ah, yes. The problem with mass market paperbacks. They are not made to last. Perhaps this is a sign that you should get back to solving your own murder, huh, detective?
Don't forget, it could have been the delirium tremens. In your hand, you hold four-fifths of Dick Mullen and the mistaken identity.
Damn it! Is it too late for a refund on this damn book?
Date of birth generator. You were born in the year 07.
Okay.
In the last year of the Commune of Revachol, right before it fell, in the old military hospital on the ground floor.
I just did the math.
Where people usually came to die.
It's 51 right
now. Snowstorm. The revolution had about 1 year left to go, and the fires were still burning bright. There were explosions in the blizzard. This was 44 years ago. You are 44 years old. The bloating might never leave your face, but beneath it, you still have some years. You still have some hope.
Hey, this is good. This is also good. Not that I really need it. As long as we're here, and quite frankly, don't have much else to do with these skill points at this point. What else we got? Bankruptcy sequence? Insolidium miracle, cleaning out the... The problem here is we don't... Yeah, you know what? Sure. We don't have a lot of time to internalize these. And indeed, we may not actually see any of them. But at least this one doesn't hurt. Alright, those books burned a lot of time. I wonder if the police ledger will do the same. That's right, there was a thing in the police ledger that we hadn't done yet. Where is it? Oh, yeah.
It's the ledger you found. Oh, and the cool piece of toilet paper is stuck to the back. It takes about half an hour to piece one together, using the system you've devised. Which one do you want?
The unsolvable case.
A.K.A. Leslie and Burke. A.K.A. The public indecency drunk and the property damage drunk is a cursed case. It has been passed from unsuspecting officer to unsuspecting officer for 10 years. On January 29, the unsolvable case made its way to you. Why you accepted it, it is unclear. Every officer, and indeed most civilians in general, know it's unsolvable. You were so drunk, you didn't remember what it was when you signed on. That, or you were high.
Great.
Leslie will always take his pants off when he's drunk. Burke will always trash everything. It's just what they do. It is their nature. You cannot change the nature of a man. And you can't lock them away, because public indecency and small-scale property damage are not punishable by incarceration.
But repeat offenses could be.
The only way for Leslie to stop displaying his genitals and for Burke to stop attacking things would be for them to stop drinking alcohol, which in their 40s or 50s, it's hard to tell because of their distorted features, is a medical improbability.
Can we just keep them off the streets?
You would think that, but you're wrong. Where's the fun in exposing your genitals or breaking stuff in your own home? No. Leslie and Burke are on the corner of Main Street and Perdition, because that's where the action is. Can you keep yourself off the streets?
Fair.
Threatening, fines, dragging them to the station, locking them up in the hell holes they live in, locking them up in the station, hypnotherapy, even trying to get the local gang of Zemyaki to take them out. The Zemyaki gave them ethanol, so Burke and Leslie would expose and rampage even harder. You tried it all, and still the complaints wouldn't stop, as they hadn't stopped for 10 years.
Wow.
It's plain to see from the files that you, Satellite Officer JV, and Special Consultant TH, had more important cases to attend to. You uncover cross-reference to several ongoing investigations, each brought to a standstill every time you drive down Main Street. Because there they are, on the corner of Perdition. And what is Leslie doing?
Public indecency.
Good, you're learning. If the files are to be trusted, that's all there is to it. That and Burke breaking things, and the fact that they're both drunk. But then again, so are you. The case becomes considerably less comic one day when Burke takes a swing at your ledger. He must have it confused with the property he likes to damage. But the joke's on him. The officer is also drunk. Way more drunk than Burke there. And let's be fair, you also have party eyes. You slam the hardened plastic board in his face, then proceed to beat him unconscious with it.
Okay.
In the process, the ledger sustains damage. The compartment within, reserved for permeable documents, is jammed shut. You stop your assault on the now unconscious Burke to open it, but are unable to do so. The officer began to cry, reports Leslie, who, at this point, is tending to Burke. Kill them. They broke it.
Okay, Half-Light.
He came at us, and at us. I think he was trying to kill Burko. While trying to kill Burko, you slowly come around. The permeable's compartment is open. You've smashed it open on poor Burko's kneecaps. The good news is, Burke can't walk anymore. Can't get out of his apartment, an invalid. With Burke to tend to, Leslie cuts back on the indecent exposure. Maybe he flashes his genitals to Burke, who knows, but both drunks are off the street. The complaints stop. The unsolvable case is solved.
Yay!
Which is also why the officer responsible narrowly escapes a disciplinary hearing. The end. Does that sound like a Raphael something Costo to you, sir?
Yes.
Fine then, you've earned it.
Stop this instant! Go! I'm really glad it let me do this. I wasn't sure that it was going to let me do that. Revisit
not
this.
Not much has changed.
Now I really want to know what's
in. A bunch of sodden papers still sags from the clipboard.
Just open the compartment. Just open it.
The two sides of the board appear slightly misaligned, like a drawer.
We don't have to be excited about it.
If you bend the plastic on your knee slowly, the slides snap back into place. It should be possible to just, you know.
I'm ready for the damage. Let's go.
Without resistance or sound, the two panels move against each other. The compartment is now open.
What's inside?
Two ticket stubs and a handmade postcard.
Pick up the ticket stubs.
Two octopuses are smiling, reaching their tentacles toward each other in the colored pencil drawings. The tickets permit access to the zoo in Revachol East. The aquarium costs extra. These let you go there, too.
Let's proceed.
Thin wax paper has been glued to a piece of cardboard. Sounds like leaves rustling when you pick it up. You see violet flowers, floral patterns, patches of glue.
Smell it?
It smells of chewing gum. Apricot flavored.
This is now relevant?
Exactly like the gum wrapper you found. The same brand of chewing gum.
Open it.
Familiar handwriting lines the inside of the card. Looped, round letters in a woman's hand. A young woman in her 20s. There is care, effort, and a smile, you think. Although that is not something you can read from someone's handwriting. Harry, it begins. You're already reading. I wanted to write you a letter so you can read it when you wake up. Maybe it will make you happy. Throw it away, please.
But it will make me happy.
Outside, you hear the wind howl. A sudden gale blows in from Martinez, flapping street signs and window blinds.
Hi, Ark. Welcome in. We're reading some things that we had hidden away in our police ledger in a hidden compartment. And every one of my psyche stats is like, oh my God, don't read that. Put that away. Please, no. Don't do it. Don't do it. I'm doing it.
Come outside.
What?
Far away and outside, the reeds hiss with desperation. Step out.
I'll take this outside.